What's up, y'all? This is Revolutionary Fitness Radio, episode 10. Welcome to another episode of Revolutionary Fitness Radio. I'm your host, Sean Garcia, and this is the podcast dedicated to bringing health, fitness, and wellness to the people. Our goal, empowering you all to understand your body, treat it well, and give you the tools to become an agent of change in your community through helping others. Let's move together.
What you know about the running, the stretching, the colors, the weapons, the path, the journey, the jewels, the learning, the fear, the focus, the aches, the pains, the contact sparring, the breaks, the sprains, the trial and error, the ranks and belts, the spiritual growth, the science of breath, the tests, the techniques, the forms, the stances, the flow, the rhythm, the internal answers, the herbs, the healing, the quiet meditation, the truths revealed through daily dedication, the love for the art, the sweat on your shirt, the mind, the body, and the spirit at work, the feelings of failure, the hopes to succeed, the battles with questions like should I smoke weed, the water, the thirst, the cleansing, the blessings, the flash of insight, the teachings, the lessons, the grappling and locking, trapping and boxing, the training and slacking, the starting, stopping, and staying committed when your homies ain't with it, the hours of practice after the class is finished, the cause of your ignorance, flaws in your discipline, broken laws of...
As always, very excited to be back for another episode of Revolutionary Fitness Radio, brought to you by Revolutionary Fitness. You can find us at revolutionaryfitness.org, and you can find us on Facebook at RevFitNYC. For those who don't know about Revolutionary Fitness, we are a nonprofit organization based out of New York City, and we deliver health services and health education in low-income neighborhoods, really trying to empower our neighborhoods to get healthier, take control of their destiny, and really, energize our communities to make some real change in their worlds. So today's episode, obviously, we're at episode number 10. Very excited about that, you know, getting into the double digits. We're just very, very glad that we've gotten so much feedback and such great response to the show. And it really encourages us and motivates us as a team to really just bring you the best content possible and to get the best guests on this show that we possibly can, so that we can, you know, help our community out, address the questions that people in our community are having, and really bring on some guests not only that have very valuable information, but that our community can deeply connect with. And that's very important to us. So today's tip of the week is embracing your weaknesses. Now, this obviously can apply to many different areas of your life, but in terms of fitness, nutrition, and wellness, embracing your weaknesses is really a humbling experience, but also one of the most empowering things you can do. First of all, just finding weaknesses. So whether you're training and you find a limitation in terms of how much weight you can move, or you're running a race and you run into, you know, you hit a wall, or you're trying to do a certain movement and you just find that you don't have the fluidity to do that movement, just the fact that you found that weakness is just a great discovery in itself. You know, it's something that you should embrace. You should be, you know, excited to find weaknesses. And I know that sounds kind of weird, because usually what the natural reaction is when we find a weakness is to avoid it, at all costs. When we get into the gym, we kind of gravitate to the things that we like doing, or the things that we're familiar with, or the things within our comfort zone. Or if we know we have a certain weakness, we usually just kind of skim over it and hope that it'll work itself out. And really, that's exactly the opposite what you should do. Every time you go into the gym, every time you work out, you should be working out on that body part that's the weakest in your body, the tightest in your body, the one that you just hate working on, that movement that you just like, oh, I hate doing that stuff. Most likely, that's the stuff you should be doing all the time. And if you address those weaknesses and you get stronger at your weaknesses, it makes your whole overall fitness that much better. Now imagine you had like 3 or 4 strengths, things that you're just great at, and you just focus on those 3 or 4 things and you just get really, really good at them, and you get so much better at them, and you're performing, you know, personal records every week. Maybe it's like bench pressing, you're really good at bench press, and every week you're just hitting new thresholds and everyone in the gym is looking at you like you're, you know, fantastic on the bench press and all that stuff, blah, 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 blah. Now imagine You just stopped bench pressing. You stopped doing all the things that you're really good at, and you found the four or five, six things that you're bad at, and you start getting, addressing those and getting better at them and finding success in those areas. Not only now are you good at those four or five things, but now you have these other four or five things that you're adding to your arsenal. So now you're really good at 10 things, and that's how you can get to the next level. And chances are, when you start addressing many of those weak areas, whether it's tightness, weakness, lack of fluidity on movement, whatever it is, when you start addressing those areas, chances are the areas that you are good at are actually going to get better, and you're going to hit it to the next threshold. A great example of this is folks who go in the gym and who are trying to get really, you know, good on bench presses. Let's use that example. Now, usually people who are really good on bench pressing are very, very tight in their anterior shoulders. So the front of their shoulders, their chests are very tight, and their back is usually rounded, and there's a lot of underdevelopment in the middle of their back because they're constantly doing, you know, repetitious movement in one direction and a lot of weight. So it kinds of causes rounding at the shoulders and this bad, you know, flexibility on the front side of the body. And now, you know, if you step away from the bench press and start focusing maybe on flexibility of those shoulders, flexibility of the chest, you know, working on strengthening of the back, now not only are you going to get really strong in your back, your flexibility is going to increase, which is going to help your performance and other things. But now when you start working on your bench again, now you have a more flexible, full range of motion on that movement. So you can take it to the next height and pass some limitations or some plateaus that you might have. And that's just a brief lesson amongst many that you can have in terms of training. But where it all starts, embrace your weaknesses. Love your weaknesses. Address them every day. Do the exercises you hate, and you'll get better at everything overall. Hope that helps. All right, guys, so we got Diallo Frazier on the phone today. Very excited to have Diallo on here. Diallo was born out in Chicago, raised in L.A. In L.A., he became affixed in the street life at an early age. In his late 20s, though, he turned away from that and moved towards more social activism. And he began to use the combat system that kept him alive on the streets to draw others away from the hardships of street life. Diallo has worked with YMCA, Boys and Girls Club, Phoenix House, teaching drug-addicted youth 52 blocks as a way to discipline their minds. He's also ran his own nonprofit in the early 2000s, and that had a 52 blocks youth program. Diallo has since trained with some well-known celebrities such as Stickman from Dead Prez, Ludacris, Lorenz Tate, and others. And he's worked on the fight choreography for the BET movie Gun Hill, directed by Reggie by the Wood, coming out this year, and also Fast 7. And Diallo is also an author, a director of documentaries. He put out a documentary called Ghetto Scriptures and much, much more. And we'll learn about that today. So, Diallo, what's up, man?
What's going on? Appreciate you having me on the show today.
Yeah, thanks for making the time. So the first question we kind of ask everybody when they get onto the show is kind of how did you get into fitness, to fighting? We know a little bit from your bio, but if you could go into more depth about that.
Well, fitness and martial arts in particular was something that was really given to me by my brother. My brother, when we was in Chicago, had a crazy temper, and he was fighting a lot in the streets. And my grandmother at the time grabbed him and said, look, you know, I can't afford to send both of y'all to know. She used to call it karate with a D, not a T. You know, karate. And she's like, I'm going to send you this karate, and you need to go ahead and get your mind right, because you can't be out here on the streets and end up something worse or happen to you. You can't beat up everybody. She's telling my brother he couldn't beat up the world. And he went to take some class, some JKD classes, and which is Bruce Lee's system. And he would come back home and basically beat the mess out of me, but he called me, training me. And so I started learning martial arts from him, and we would all, and then he would also, we watched Shaolin movies, and he for some reason thought he was the grand master, and he would have me do all kind of holding potato sacks up. He'd have me run up, but he would do it too, but I wasn't volunteering to do it. I wanted to watch cartoons and sleep. But took it upon himself to train me, which actually came in handy because it changed my whole life and my perspective of exercise, health, fitness, and martial warriorship and having it and becoming a warrior. He was the first one that really focused me, and he was young. But we grew up in a different era. Everybody wanted to be a warrior, you know, Kung Fu theater, karate theater, all that stuff. And Bruce Lee was very big influence on our life. And my brother was the first person that really got me into martial arts and the health and fitness.
That's what's up. So obviously then in your later years, you said you got infixed in the streets. Can you talk about what was going on there and what you participated in?
Later on, you know, my brother ended up going to the Air Force. He joined the Air Force. So he became a professional warrior. Mm-hmm. When he went off, my mind and I felt kind of lost because he was the only male. He was that male figure for me. I looked up to my brother a lot. And when he left, I was in a situation where it was gangs and drugs and street thugs and everybody around. And it wasn't like, you know, I had my brother for my backup. And I ended up getting entrenched in it by accident. I ended up getting jumped. And when I got jumped, it changed my whole thought process. And I felt like I needed somebody to have my back. And once that happened, I got somebody to have my back. And then I became entrenched in banging and survival on the streets. And that was my focus at that time, unfortunately. But actually, fortunately, those things actually made me into who I am right now. So those things were meant to happen, and sometimes we don't see it that way when we're going through it, but I became very infixed in street life and hustling.
Got it. And so I read your book, Revelations of a Warrior, which is a great piece, and we'll put the link to the Amazon purchase in the show notes. Everybody should definitely check that out. And I remember when I was reading it, some of the things I was connecting with very deeply were, you know, because when people think of martial arts and combat training and all this stuff, they think of a very formal structure of kind of, you know, going to school, learning your katas, you know, learning your forms and all this stuff. And, you know, there's some sparring and there's some application and, you know, some people go on to actually compete in fights and all that kind of stuff. But you really talked a lot about, you know, the real life, you know, being in real life combat, the different dynamics that are at play, you know, fearing for one's life, not being friends, you know. It's just a different. Can you go deeper into that? How they differ?
Yes. You know, all respect to the organized combat, because now I train MMA fighters, but it's a completely different mentality when you know that you can either tap out or there's a ref to help you when you get knocked out if you're a boxer or a kickboxer or a Muay Thai fighter or. In wrestling, you know, there's really no submissions. In jiu-jitsu, you can tap out. So it's no tap out on the street. You know, if the tap out may be your death or a permanent injury. It becomes a different mindset. And a lot of times your mind will will you for survival purposes. Your mind will take over and have you do things that somebody that may be bigger, stronger, and may but not have that will to survive that you have, and when that comes in on play on the streets, it's not a place to play. It's not a place to feel comfortable. And when you're on the streets, also you're in that switch is on all the time. You know, you hear a lot of fighters, organized fighters, say, you know, they know how to turn the switch on when they hit the ring, and then when they're out the ring, they're fine and they're cool. But when you're on the streets, that switch is on all the time. Mm-hmm. It's never a turnoff point because you never know where you're going to go and the enemy is going to attack. You never know when your life will be put in danger. So you always have to be in an alert mode. So it differs completely. And when a man hasn't ever been in a position where his life has really been put in danger, he doesn't know when he's about to die. He doesn't know when his life is really in danger and how severe the beating is. And if you are haven't been put in those positions, then you don't comprehend those positions. You also learn how to get out of those positions, how to evade those positions, and how to attack with extreme force when necessary. And it's just a different mentality. It's no shaking hands. It's no hugging afterward. You know, it's I got to do what I got to do to survive, and I need to get out of this situation before his homeboys come. It's no going on the ground and grappling, because if you do that, somebody's going to come and kick you in your head and stomp you out. Mm-hmm. You have to be aware of everything. And then in any real street fight, weapons come into play too. You know, you might have to grab a tent off a car and start whipping somebody. You might have to grab a branch off a tree and start defending yourself. You know, these things, that's another reason that you have to know your weapons training, because weapons play always comes into play when you're in the street. Not saying that somebody might pull a knife out you. Now, this is not the movies. You're not going to just stick your arm out and stop a knife from cutting you. You're going to get cut. So you look for a weapon. You create weapons. Improvised weapons is something that you also create. You know, your keys become brass knuckles. Your change becomes a throwing weapon to distract and hit somebody in the face to throw them off, and so you can attack them when they have that weapon. Like I said before, grabbing antennas, sticks, poles, picking up a rock, anything becomes a weapon, but you have to learn how to actually put yourself in that mode to create improvised weapons. And that's something that my brother actually taught me when he was doing the torture training that he did.
I mean, the Jeet Kune Do, I mean, out of many of the systems, or, you know, whatever you want to call Jeet Kune Do out there, it probably has some direct application for you because of this whole spontaneity and the street fighting that JKD kind of, you know, addresses. So that probably helped you out a lot.
It helped me out a great deal. Yeah. And that's what, like, what my brother... A lot of stuff that he said, like, I called him a prophet of combat, because he would put scenarios and we'd go over scenarios and do things. And then I would actually see them work that way out in a street fight. And it was amazing. Like, afterward, I wasn't not going to fight, but, you know, afterward you reflect and you start thinking, like, dang, that actually worked. So maybe this stuff ain't just, you know. My brother actually know what he's talking about and doing.
Yeah,
something.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think a lot of us can relate to the experience that you're talking about, you know. And what I think is cool about your perspective is that you're talking about the, you know, combat fighting in the streets from our neighborhoods as a system, as you know, something that has some structure and there's teachings. And because I think about my father has a similar, you know, grew up in a similar situation that you did, a street enforcer for gangs and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, he would teach me, I was a young kid, and he would teach me all these things and give me all these lessons. And we weren't in a formal, you know, studio or a gym or anything like that. But those lessons are really what molded my initial fighting techniques and, you know, I was able to use later. So can you talk about the, you know, that formal, you know, structure that people, I would say, don't respect, you know, fighters that are coming from the hood because they don't think they have formal training, but we were different, and, right?
I mean, life training is, to me, real formal training. I mean, again, I'm not disrespecting any dojo training or anything like that. I respect that. I know they work hard, but a lot of times they don't respect the opposite end. And the opposite end is that you are being trained. I'm going to give you an example. When I first, when I was on the streets and doing my thing, a guy named Big Ant is who took me under his wing and taught me 52 blocks. And we never were in no dojo or anything like that, but he would just, like, come over. I'd go through his house or we'd go to the park, and he would show me these, you know, would look like flashy hand movements and angling and all this. It looked great, but he was showing me these moves, and there was no, you know, there was no formal training, stand here and do that. He would just show me the moves and say, look, D, this is how you do it. And then sometimes I would just come around and you slap box with your homies, and I'll do something, and he would do something with his hands, and I'd be looking like, how did he do that? He was like 6'2", 6'3", and the dude was like 250, but his hands were so quick. And I couldn't comprehend how a big dude's hands were so fast. Mm. And it was, you know, it was those 52 movements, but he would just be able to do things informally. And sometimes it was like from slap boxing or just to do something, I'll just grab him and it would be out of nowhere. And then he would show me what he did. Mm. And I was like, it was formal, but informal. We weren't even supposed, like at one time, I believe we was at, I remember that we was at In-N-Out. And I walk up to him I'm meeting him at In-N-Out. I come from behind, and I grab his shoulder, and he spins around and protects himself with his elbow when he spins around and hooks my arm with his elbow and then slightly elbows me in my chest. And I'm like, what the heck just happened right there? And he shows me exactly what he did. He's like, you like that, don't you? I'm like, yeah, I like that. How that happened? And then he showed me that. But that was like the type of training that he would do. It would just be spontaneous training. He'd do something to me, show it to me, and then it'd be in my head, and I'd go practice it. And that's how my 52 training was. It was even less formal than what my brother was doing. Mm-hmm. So it was this. People have to realize that everybody, when they train, it's not what you, just because it's not organized the way you think it to be organized, it is an organized training, but just in a true and real environment. I mean, I call it the Mr. Miyagi effect. You know, Mr. Miyagi had Daniel-san waxing cars and cleaning stuff, and he didn't know he was actually doing moves. It's not in that sense where I knew what I was doing, but he would just do it out of real life situations, and we would just train and it was called informal, but to me it was formal.
Right. So before we get deeper into 52 blocks, I mean, we're not trying to fetishize street life and encourage people to get involved. And in fact, it's probably the opposite. But, you know, can you talk about, you mentioned that your social activism started blossoming later, you know, in your 20s. Can you talk about how that came about? What were some of the movements you were involved in and why you felt like it was a transition you needed to make?
But for me, you know, I had my son and I had my daughter, and my daughter came when I was 26. And my son changed my life. He made me calm down a little bit, but I still felt, you know, I needed to do something. But it was really about my daughter, and she made me look at stuff a little bit differently. And I always said, you know, I got to be that man in her life to be a father, to make her see things. I didn't want her to look at the example of manhood being a street guy. Mm-hmm. And that's what she ended up being with. And I was always had some type of social activism in my soul because my father, Max Frazier, was a social activist. He was also one of the founders of SUN back in the 60s. It was called Society of United Negroes. Mm-hmm. He was took when I was just 6 months. And so I used to have his books too, and that influenced me greatly. His books, 15 Familiar Faces and Black and Unequaled, always were something that I read and always was in my mind socially. Mm. And like I said, when my daughter was born, my mindset really focused on what type of man do I show her a real man is, and social activism was something that I always looked at because of being in that street life. I realized that most people that I was dealing with, most people that were around me didn't want to be street soldiers. That wasn't their goal in life. They didn't wake up and say, you know what, I want to bang, I want to slang, I want to street hustle, that's not what they wanted. It was circumstances, you know, parents, drug addicted, alcoholics, being in circumstances where, you know, you get jumped and you can't survive without somebody having your back. It was just circumstances that made them do that. But I knew that most of them were just warriors that were unguided. And that's what made me look to see, like, you know, what can I do to take the knowledge that I have as a warrior and focus my young brothers to become warriors and not gangsters and hustlers and pimps and stick-up kids, but to refocus that into a warrior mentality. And like I said, a lot of it had to do with my daughter. A lot of it had to do with my father's books. But, you know, my daughter's and what a man and creating what a man should be to her was my main focus. And then also seeing my brother suffering, and mothers suffering, mothers seeing the young boys dying for a cause that wasn't a good death, and just seeing the hurt, the pain, having homeboys that have been murdered, and going to their funerals, it was a lot of pain, and I didn't want other people to experience the pain that I had. And I felt like I had an obligation to be able to be surviving this long, to have two children, to be blessed by the Most High. Then I lived past what I was supposed to, so it was time.
It was
time for me to give back.
So what do you think it is about fitness and martial arts that really could be a transformative tool that you were able to use to, you know, work with these youth?
I believe that, you know, most of these youth that I'm looking at, as far as, you know, street guys and gang members, and that those guys are misguided warriors. Mm. And a warrior has to have a focus and a physical nature that we're always going to have. And if you can focus that warrior mentality through exercise, fitness, martial arts, then it changes the whole dynamic of that warrior, because now his mind is focused on other things that he can build from his warrior code. Warriors ultimately, and when I train people, because I just don't physically train you, I train you and we philosophize, and ultimately a warrior is a servant to the people.
Mm.
Ultimately, a warrior is put on this planet to help out the poor, to help out the weak, to help out the voiceless, to give a voice to the voiceless. Now, when you realize that and you focus these young warriors, then they become the leaders of their communities, of their schools, of their jobs, or they create jobs. That's what I see that fitness and martial arts can do for these young warriors, because it redefines who they are. Because you're not gang members, you're not gangsters, you're not hustlers, you're not stick up kids. That's not what you are. In your nature, you are a warrior. You just don't, nobody's told you, nobody's focused you, nobody's given you a philosophy of strength. And because you can't tell these guys to come out and all of a sudden be soft. They earned them stripes. They hard, and you don't disrespect that, and you don't take that away. And you recognize their strength, and you recognize their greatness, and you recognize who they are as leaders, and you develop that. And I think you can do that through fitness and martial arts.
Yeah, definitely. Everyone listening, you press that little rewind button. Listen to that answer for a couple more seconds. This is a great answer. So, can you give us an example of somebody you know you might have worked with in the past, or you're working with currently, that you feel like you have an effect on with this kind of training?
I can give you a couple. I got Cat Wine, but I'm gonna give you a person that I worked with in the past. I've worked with people consistently, but it was a guy that my nonprofit, which was Toolshed, back in the early 2000s, had a nonprofit, and a guy named Phil Leonard brought this young man, Nick, to me, Nick LaRusso. And Nick was in the streets. He was consistently fighting. He was hustling on the streets. He was what you call a street soldier. And he actually ended up going to Toolshed. Phil Leonard was our director at Toolshed. And we actually had a program where if you went to court and you had to be on probation and you wanted to find a faster way to get off probation within LA system, you could come to us and we would work with you, and we would take you in, work with you, and then your behavior would change, and within a 6-month period you can get off probation.
Mm.
And if you did the program. And we had him come in, and he was a knucklehead. Nobody couldn't tell him anything. He didn't want to hear anything. He knew what it was, and we were some L7s that couldn't tell him anything.
Mm-hmm.
And he was dealing with Phil at first, and then Phil met me up at this park with him. And he said, you know, I got this guy. We can't get, you know, he doesn't want to get through with us. He's too hard. He I need him to meet you. I was like, well, I'm working with somebody else, but I'm going to come meet you. And I came and met with Nick. I know it seems like I'm dragging the story on. I'm trying to hurry up.
Do your thing.
Met with Phil and Nick at this park. Nick had his mean mug on, looking tough. And I said, okay. I was like, why are you looking tough, brother? What's going on? And his response is, you know, it ain't no joke on these streets, so I'm going to have to, you know, keep this mean mug, blah, blah, blah. And I said, look, man, I want to show you how to take that energy that you have and convert it into a positive warrior energy. And he went on, you know, what you talking about and all this other stuff. And I said, look, man, that sparked real quick. I got some gloves. I got this. And he, you know, man, I don't want to put these things on you, blah, blah, blah. Basically, we sparred. I had fun hurting him. Not in a bad way. But I just had to make a point with him. And once I made that point with him, he wanted to know how I was able to beat him because he felt like nobody could touch his hands. Mm. And once I got him there, he was the greatest student, probably one of the best that I've ever had in my life. And Nick just picked up everything. And all he wanted to do was soak it up. And then once I had the physical, then I started hitting him with the philosophical, the warrior strength, the mindset, the discipline, the things that you have to, you know, that a warrior is ultimately a servant to his community. Those things I started putting in his head and explaining to him about warrior philosophy. Then I started giving him different books to read about warrior life. I gave him The Code of the Samurai. I gave him The Book of Five Rings. Gave him my book. So he began to change, and I saw the shift in him, and his mindset went on to become, he became a warrior. And, you know, this day he works as a community, not a community, but a social worker. So it works. Once you get the physical and somebody respects you physically, then it's easier for them to listen to you. Yep. When they come from that background, or when they know that you come from the same background, they respect you.
Dope.
Sometimes I don't have to do the extreme as far as sparring. Sometimes I can just sit there and let them know what my story was. And they, when you relate, another brother's going to listen to you and soak in your game.
Mm. Yeah. And I think that's why it's so essential to have, you know, to be doing this work in our own communities, have people from our own communities leading this work. And, you know, being the mentors and all that good stuff. So we're going to take a quick break, but we'll be back with more with Diallo Frazier.
Thank you.
Down. sorrow. Maybe it's inside the bottle.
Maybe it's inside the bottle.
I had some good old buddies, names is whiskey and wine.
Hey, hey.
And for my good old buddies, I spend my last dime.
Hey, hey.
Now wine is good to me. You help me pass the time. And my good old buddy whiskey keep me warmer than sunshine.
Hey, hey.
Your mama may have blessed the child that's got his own.
Hey, hey.
If God has plans for me, I hope it ain't written in stone.
Hey, hey.
Because I've been working, working myself down.
All right, guys, so we're back with Diallo. Diallo's just been breaking down, his history with street culture, combat training, and how he started using it to bring about some social change. So, Diallo, I wanted to go into, before we went to break, you were kind of talking about, being able to connect with folks because you were able, to relate to them because you were from the same community. Can you talk a little bit more about why you think that's such a played a such an important role with your impact on these communities?
I think within our communities and our hood communities that we respect people that's been through what we went through and then have made it out. Because when you look at somebody that may be from the outside of our community and they don't know what the struggle is, you a lot of times, I'm not saying everyone, but a lot of times these outside people that don't know the struggle will come in and say, well, why don't you just do this? Mm-hmm. Or it's just simply to do this and that. And they haven't ever been put in the position that you've been in. So listening to them is like, man, you don't even know my struggle, so I can't even listen to you. So they'll tune out no matter what they say. They might be giving them great knowledge and great tools, but they'll tune out because it all boils down to, if you've never been through what I went through, how you going to tell me how to get out of it? It's like this. If you've never been punched in the face, how are you going to tell me how I feel?
Mm.
And how to react to it? You can't. So when they see somebody from their own struggle, from their own base, from their own mindset, speaking their own language, in their own dialect, then it's like, okay, I can feel where this cat is coming from. This brother's been through this and that. I know that he's seen this because the way he talks, the scenarios he breaks down, I've been through the same exact scenarios. I had the same alcoholic mom, drug addicted mom. I had the same problems with gangs in my neighborhood. I had the same mentality where I know that I don't want to be doing this lifestyle, but I know I have to do this to survive. And that's a lot of times people on the outside try to demonize brothers on the streets. Like, we have no heart. We have no soul. We want to just, take Mike Tyson's word, eat your children. You know what I'm saying? You know, that's how they portray us a lot. And when they hear it from somebody from their own background, from their community, it's a completely different thing, because I know you have a soul. I know you have a heart. Some of the craziest dudes I've known were some of the funniest dudes I've known.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the hardest gangbangers in L.A. that I've known were also some of the most heartful people that you know. They wanted to help out communities. They would take money that they had. Like, my homeboy Derek Morgan is an ex-drug dealer, and he felt bad for slanging dope. So bad that this guy would actually have his own version of church in his house every Sunday with his smoker that he sold to him because he felt bad.
Mm.
And he'd be like, look, that's just read the Bible today. I'm not going to sling dope on Sundays. I want y'all to listen to this. And he would hope that they would find a way out of their struggle, even though he was selling them dope. These were his customers.
Mm.
But I've seen these type of things. And people on the outside have it. So they don't know how to relate. They don't know how to talk. They don't know that these are the most heartfelt, strong leaders that you can possibly find on this planet, are on these streets and in these hoods and within these gang systems. These are some great men, and they just have to be guided right. And when you come from that environment, you see it, and when you talk it, they can feel it. They don't just hear your words; they feel them, and that's the difference. And
yeah.
that's the, importance of somebody coming from your community.
I mean, I think also, too, if you think about the redirecting of the energy, you know, if you think about back into, you know, the 60s and 70s, most of the social activists that were leading the way were, you know, converts from the streets or people who grew up in our communities. I mean, you think of the Panthers and the Young Lords, you know, many of these guys were, you know, initially hustlers or gangsters, and then they became the leaders at the forefront, you know, battling the cops and standing up for their communities.
And they had no fear because they was warriors, too. Exactly. So that was like the greatest thing. And what you're saying is just completely true. And that's what I'm trying to say in a nutshell, is that your greatest leaders, your philosophers, your warriors are sitting in these environments, and they haven't been nurtured. Once they're nurtured, it's an unstoppable force.
Mm. Dope, dope. So can you talk more about 52 Blocks and kind of what that is?
52 is a combat system developed from a slave system called Virginia Scuffling. Back in the 1800s, they had slave fights. And the slave fights were Virginia Scufflers. And they used the systems that they brought over from the fatherland, Africa. You know, some of the systems were Hussein Boxing, Reese, other African systems that ended up being blended together and used in these Virginia Scufflings. I mean, some of the slave chronicles and slave master notes they talk about these Virginia Scufflers and how vicious and deadly that they were when they would have fights. Slave, you know, one plantation slave would represent the other plantation slave, and they would, you know, have these slave fights. After the Civil War, when, you know, slavery was over, a lot of the Virginia Scufflers end up being in the jail systems. Mm. And from there, I'm trying to, you know, give you a quick history.
No,
went to the jail systems through Black Code. Black Code was the system to basically try to re-implement slavery legally after it was supposedly abolished. So that was also the beginning of the prison industrial complex. So they put a lot of these Virginia Scufflers were once they were free, they were a lot of defiant. And so they were not defiant, and from our perspective, they was demanding their freedom. But from the system's perspective, they were looked at as defiant. They were put in these jail systems. And from the jail systems, the system of Virginia Scuffling changed and became more of a close quarter, improvised weapon system. And it was renamed Jailhouse Rock.
Mm.
After coming out, migrating from the South, when people did get out of jails, they migrated north, west, east. And once they migrated, the systems spread around the United States. But 52 was renamed in New York after 52 car game, 52 pickup, which means let the cars. So 52 basically stands for let the cars lie where they may, or anything goes. Once it got out of the jail systems and it went onto the streets, it became more of an angling movement, a non-traditional, almost dance-like fight. It looks pretty, but it's a dance of death. It's a deadly dance. So everything that is done is not superfluous. Everything that done is done with the purpose of destruction of an enemy. It's an offensive defense. You're using defensive moves that are offensive weapons, which is your elbows, your head fighting, your footwork, just a lot of hand movement. It's a deadly, deadly dance.
So for those who are listening who may be martial artists, martial art practitioners, can you talk about some things that differ 52 from other combat systems?
I mean, the best way I can describe it is that it's the American Capoeira, except it's the Capoeira use more movement with the legs and kicks. We have more in close quarter fighting, and our hand movement is consistently movement of blinding, hypnotizing with your hands. And I'm sitting there doing it right now, but you can't see. it differs from its rhythm, because we call it rhythm of self. You develop your rhythm of self, and your rhythm of self is a rhythm that you, it's the beat. It's that fight beat that we all have in us, but once you learn a certain techniques, the up rock of the 52, the hand movements of the 52, from the peekaboo to the skull and crossbones, to the kiss of elbows, windshield wipes, whatever it may be, you learn these movements, and these movements are consistently moving within the system. I mean, like I said, it looks almost like a dance. I would ask, you know, if the audience, after they get off of this, go to YouTube and put in 52 box, you can see it, because it's deadly, it's close quarter, and it's a non-traditional rhythm. Like I said, I would consider it the American capoeira. It's like I said, it kind of looks almost dance and flashy, but it's a flash that will give you that blue flash when you get hit in the eye. Mm-hmm.
So is there a lot of folks formally training 52 in the States, or is it just informal, like you were saying initially, how you got into it? What's the status right now?
Right now, you have a lot more people formally being trained. I came out with some tapes back in 2005 on 52. And from there, it seemed to spark a lot of other people who knew 52 to come out of the woodworks and start doing their things and start to build on their end. So now I'm going to say my mission was, when I first came out with my tapes in 52 and I started to try to bring the 52 to the 21st century, was to, because when I, in 2005, I Googled 52. And you couldn't find one thing on 52 blocks, not one. And I said, in 10 years, I plan on making sure that everybody in this world knows 52. And if I Google 52, everything is going to be a whole lot of things come up. So since that time, which is before 10 years, a lot of people have come out. A lot of people are out there training in 52, formally training in 52. You have people like Daniel Marks. You have people like Light Burley. You have people like Romeo. They call him Mr. 52. They're out there in New York in the East Coast. You still have the Elder. Dennis Newsom out here in the West Coast, up in San Diego, me. And I plan on certifying a couple of people this year who've been with me for like 3 years. And my man, Juan Hooks, who's originally from St. Louis, he'll be going out back to St. Louis once he's certified and teaching out there. So it's people around. You can find it now, and it's built, and it's a great movement. I love it.
Yeah, sounds dope. I mean, is there a way to get access to those videos that you did back in the days? Do you have them online, digitally, anywhere?
You can find them on fightfast.com. You can go to fightfast.com and type in my name on a search engine or something, and they should come up.
Cool. So I'll try to get those in the show notes as well, so people can get access to that and see what's going on with this fight system. I mean, it seems like one of the most traditional American fight systems out there. You know, and many people don't know about it because of the way that our history has been treated in this country. You know, we talk about Latinos, yeah, and African Americans, how, yeah, our history is just erased, along with things like our traditional fighting systems and all that kind of stuff. So it's a great movement for sure. So how did you get involved with working with some celebrities? Because I know you say you work with Ludacris and Stig.
Stig, well, a lot of it really started from the gym that I work at out here. It's in Van Nuys, California. It's the name of the gym is House of Champions. And House of Champions, we train consistently. I believe we have one of the best and most underrated gyms in the country, if not just California. But the owner, Mark Parr, does a lot of work with does a lot of stunt coordinators, have stunt, bring stunt people in and things of that nature. But also Reggie Bikewood, who's also the writer of Notorious, Get on the Bus. He did the 30 film with Mike Tyson and Tupac Shakur's relationship. Mm. He's a great writer and director, producer. His son actually was training at our facility. And this was in 2010. And he still trains there, but this was in 2010. And Reggie's originally from the Bronx.
Mm.
And he was writing a script about this cop, this brother that brought down John Gotti, undercover brother. And we were supposed to do, he ended up saying, you know what, he was talking to Mark when Mark was, he brought his son in and he was chatting with Mark. And he was saying, man, you know, I want this, this undercover cop, he's going to go to jail. I want him to learn the system, but you know, I can't find anybody that learns it. Cause when I grew up in the Bronx, I used to see the cats always doing 52 blocks and I can't find anybody for it. And Mark was like, we got somebody here that does it. And that's how it really started. And with that script, by the way, didn't green light that script. We ended up doing the other script with Lorenz Tate, which is called Gun Hill.
Mm-hmm.
And we ended up, he asked me and Mark to put a fight scene together using 52. We did it. He loved it. And then he said, look, I got this other script now, and it's called Gun Hill. And Lorenz Tate is going to be the main character. We need you to, I need you to train him and get him ready. And that's how I first met Lorenz. And then, and I was in 2011, early 2011, started training him. And me and him hit it off. We are actually great friends now. And he ended up telling everybody about 52. Everybody, he went around, everybody was around. He, after we filmed Gun Hill, he still was training with me. He still trains me with to this day. Lorenz will probably be another one of the people that I'm going to certify because he's been with me. He'll be 3 years this year of us training consistently. And Lorenz told Chris about it.
Ludacris, yeah.
Yeah, he told Ludacris about it. And he would go out and hem him up with some 52, and they, you know, Chris was like, hey, wait a minute, what is this stuff? So he introduced me to Chris, and then I gave Chris, we sat down and talked, because no matter what, when I do train, I do like to know the mentality of the individuals that I work with. And if you don't have the correct mindset of humility, strength, and awareness, then I don't really want to deal with you.
Yeah, because it's hard enough to teach technique, then to build character is, you know, it's a whole other battle.
Yeah, exactly. And so he was one of those guys. And you represent me. And if I go out and I teach you 52, and then you out here being reckless with it, and what does that make 52 look like? It makes it look like some thug stuff. And that's the thing that we're trying to really get away with, get away from, is just to show 52 as a true martial art, from philosophy to history to discipline to deadly ability. And that's our goal. And like I said, Chris sat down with me, he talked to me, he was very interested, he was very knowledgeable, he was he had did his research, and he was just a good dude, one of the nicest guys I've ever met in my life. And we started training, and we still training to this day. So, you know, and when I went to Atlanta, that's when I met Stickman. When I was actually out with Chris one day, we met Stickman at a restaurant. We was talking, chopping it up, and just said we need to get together. And he wanted to run a 10-mile run. And I said, okay, let's run this 10-mile run. We can start chopping it up, and we start building from there. And and basically, it became a snowball of me just working with different good celebrities. I mean, people that are really good men. Lorenz is a great guy. Stickman is unbelievably intelligent, wise, good dude. Chris is the nicest, most generous individual that you can meet. And Lorenz is just Lorenz. That's just my boy. That's my dog. And Lorenz is hood. Lorenz is humble, and And he got a little meanness in him. So he's I like Range is my boy. That's my dog.
I mean, I think we need more of that too. More of folks from our communities who go on to be celebrities, whether it be in film, music, whatever it is, you know, really providing, using their platform to push forward, you know, stuff that's going on within our community. So something like 52, you know, really having some celebrities to back it really has given it, I'm sure, further exposure. I mean, that's how we connected with Stick, you know, connected me to you and introduced me to your work. And I was like, oh man, this is right on to what we believe in. And I think you're going to have more and more of that with more exposure through these celebrities. So, you know, big ups to them for sure for being able to share their platform with you and to make some bigger connections. So how did you get into, because you've written a couple books and you did the directing on the documentary. How do you get into that kind of work? You know, you're a fighter. Where's this arty stuff coming from?
You know, because you're a martial artist.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know, and ultimately a warrior, we know that he's a servant of his community, and there's different ways to serve your community. Mm-hmm. And I felt like our community can be reached through books and through film more than anything else. And again, I'm also influenced by Bruce Lee. And Bruce Lee, you know, everybody looked at him as one of the baddest men on the planet. Mm-hmm. And what did he do? He wrote books. And another thing was what you said earlier is how our history as Blacks and Latinos is like swept under the rug.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're oral people. We'll give an oral history and we'll know it. And then other people say it's a myth because it's not written down.
Mm.
And I didn't want that. And my mindset was I wanted to write down our history from my perspective, from me growing up. You know, we need hood historians.
Mm.
And we can give the real perspective of where we come from, what we are, and how we do it. And not have an outsider tell us our story. So I want to be a not just, you know, part of my warriorship is being a hood historian. And I want to jive history through film and through books. And I did that through Ghetto Scriptures, which was the documentary, which was a documentary about life within the hood, the struggles, the love, the hardships, but also how to get out through strength, through faith, through networking and building. And that was a documentary. It's called Ghetto Scriptures, and I did that with my partner at the time. Her name is Bobby Jean Stanley, and her and I went out on a mission to record our history and from an LA perspective, but it's still hood history. And to me, it's one hood and it's one nation.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one goal, and that's for all of us to build together and grow up and build our hoods, not have to move out of them, but just build them up.
Mm. And definitely. So I'm going to definitely put all that stuff in the show notes, all the links to your work. You got, what's your plan for this year? It's 2014, new year, you know, same day for us, but, you know, obviously everybody making, you know, some life-changing goals and all that good stuff. What you got going on this year? And also, too, can you add, what would be a message that you send to our listeners, a call to action maybe, that they should do in this new year?
First, with what I have planned this year, I plan on still a couple of fighters that I want to work with and that I'm still working with. And I want them out of here and help them attain their goals of getting a belt or getting further within their career.
Mm-hmm.
I also have a book that I'm going to self-publish. And the book will be called The Diallo of 52. And it'll give the history, philosophy of 52 blocks. It's not going to be a how-to book. It's going to be history and philosophy. Again, this goes back to us being able to be our own historians and tell our own story. And so nobody get to saying that it's a myth and doesn't exist and this and that. I want to put it on paper. I want it to be out there. So The Diallo of 52 is something else that I'm coming out with, and just continuously. And I want to. I should, by the end of March, I want to have my new apparel company, 52 Blocks Athletics, ready to go. And that's, that's my thing that I'm doing is I'm helping my fighters out. I'm putting this Diallo 52 out and the 52 Blocks Athletics. And, of course, I'm still going to be working with Lorenz, Chris, Stickman, everybody. I'm still on that course just to bring 52 to the world and let everybody know that we have a hood-based system. I mean, it's based from slavery, but it's the stuff that's based from slavery will obviously help us become free. Mm. And it'll free our minds, discipline our souls, and make us better men. And that is my goal for us as a hood community, Black, Latino, whatever, Samoan. We are a hood community, and I love my community. Love it.
So what's the message you got to our folks? What should they be doing this year?
The message is to build. I mean, that's what we have to do. It's the old message. It's a message that's always been there, but we have to build. We have to build our bodies, make them stronger. We have to build our minds, make them more focused. We have to build our souls, make them more encompassing to love, not to hate. Mm-hmm. And a lot of, you know, you look at what's going out there in Chicago and New Jersey. There's some real, real hectic stuff going on right now. I mean, it's going on around the hoods everywhere, but I mean, those two places right now, it's turned up. And these young men are desperate need of love, and a lot of people, and not a weak love, but a strong love. A man's focus on how to become a man, and these guys are really misguided, and they just need somebody that actually loves the hood, loves our struggle, and knows our struggle, and comes out and helps them build their minds, bodies, and souls, physically fit, mentally equipped. And we can get there. And I believe that is. So let's build.
Yeah, and what I get too from what you're saying is not only, you know, the individual building themselves up, but those who have been empowered and those who have gained some of these tools in fitness and wellness and martial arts, having a responsibility to bring it back to our communities, to build up our communities using those tools and others. Obviously, the community organizing, the social activism, all that stuff is essential as well. But really, you know, having a responsibility to, you know, feel like we need to invest in our communities. It might not be the most financially, you know, I mean, like the wisest thing to do. It's better to open a gym in a bougie neighborhood than it is in the hood to some people.
Yeah.
But we need to open more of these establishments. We need to do more of this work and build up our communities so that we don't have to go outside of our communities and into other places to try to find these sources.
Exactly. And it's a necessity, and you hit it right on the nail. And that's exactly what I am trying to articulate, is that you can't forget about your brothers and your sisters. You can't. And you have to reinvest. You can't just move out and say it's over, because it can start small. I mean, you have Stick and Move out in New York. I wish I knew the website and everything, but Stick and Move is a boxing program. And with Stick and Move, what they're doing out there, they're teaching boxing, but these young men, and they have to sit down and do their homework before they even touch a glove. Mm. They're teaching their minds. They're letting them know, look, you have to be mentally strong before you are physically able. And they're doing good stuff. And that's a small program, but
yeah, we'll try to find their stuff and put it in the show notes as well. So if you find it before I do, let me know, and we'll try to get it in there for everybody to see. You
know, I go on Facebook. I know they're on Facebook. You go Stick and Move on Facebook. Actually, I think I'm friends with them.
Okay.
But it's our obligation. It's our obligation to never forget the hood and never turn our backs on where we're from.
Definitely.
It's our obligation to help build that up. And it's gold. It's gold in the hood. It's gold and it's diamonds in the hood. We just got to mine them. Mm-hmm. And we have to mine it. We put some miners out there, then they can dig up the gold, they can dig up the diamonds, and we can flourish where we at. Mm-hmm. And I wholeheartedly believe that in my soul. I know that for a fact.
So, D, if people are trying to get in contact with you or find out more about your work, what's some resources they could tap into?
You can hit me up on Facebook. Diallo Frazier. You can get me on Twitter. It's 52 Block on Twitter. You can get me on Instagram. It's 52thoughts.
Very cool. And we'll get that in the show notes as well. All right, brother. Well, I want to thank you so much, man. This conversation was way fruitful. You know, went to a couple different directions that I didn't expect and I was excited about. So I want to thank you for sharing, you know, your experiences, your system, your thoughts on all this stuff. And definitely we want to get you back on here sometime in the future, brother.
I appreciate you, brother, more than you possibly would know. I appreciate this program. I appreciate what you guys do. Everything. I love it. I love what you're doing. I appreciate you.
Awesome, man. So we'll build soon. Talk to you later, ID.
All right, be safe, my brother. Right. Peace and a whip. NWA court is in full effect. Judge Dre residing. In the case of NWA versus the police department, prosecuting attorneys are MC Ren, Ice Cube, and Easy motherfucking E. Order, order, order. Ice Cube, take the motherfucking stand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your black ass? You goddamn right. Won't you tell everybody what the fuck you gotta say? Fuck the police coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad cause I'm brown. And not the other color, so police think they have the authority to kill a minority. Fuck that shit cause I ain't the one for a punk motherfucker with a badge and a gun to be beaten on. And thrown in jail, we can go toe to toe in the middle of a sale. Fucking with me cause I'm a teenager with a little bit of gold and a pager. Searching my car, looking for the product. Thinking every nigga is selling narcotics. You rather see me in the pen than me.